No, you don't have to be a genius to code. Do you have a favorite drink? Because if you do, it can be a good idea to keep track of how much you're drinking. Because you don't want to drink too much, right? Well, get ready for the unveiling of a breakthrough product, the Drinks Counter app. Every time you're chilling with your favorite drink, you can keep track of exactly how unhealthy you are. And if you're not into drinks, you can instead count cookies, push-ups, or the amount of money you'll make when you sell this app. So, if you're ready, let's get started. The first thing we want to show is the image. Computer, show an image. Computer, show an image. See, it doesn't work this way. We have to write some code in order to communicate with the computer. Boom, that's our first line of code. IMG is short for image. But see, the computer is confused. Which image do we want to show exactly? A rock or the rock? The picture we want it to show is called Coca-Cola.png. So let's specify that. And there we have it. SRC, by the way, stands for source. Now let's add a button. And there's our beautiful button. Now let's take a pause here, because you might already be freaking out a little bit.
Everybody stay calm!
What are these weird symbols? The crocodile mouth, the equal sign, the quotation marks. See, here's the thing. At this point, as long as you understand that we're showing an image called Coca-Cola.png and then a button that shows the plus sign, that's all that matters. The symbols could be anything. It could be the poop emoji. And the reason that they are the ones that they are is honestly because the people who invented it a long time ago decided that it should be those symbols. It's the same reason that in English we end sentences with a dot. Now, I want to keep this video as non-technical as possible, but sometimes it can be important to get used to the technical words. So here's the first one coming up.
Brace yourself.
So let's break down how our button is created. The first part is this, which is called the opening tag. With it, we're telling the computer, hey, we want to create a button. And then the computer goes, okay, what do you want to put inside of it? And that is where we put the content, which in this case is the plus sign. And then we go, okay, we're done. Let's add the closing tag at the end. And the only difference between the opening tag and the closing tag is the slash. And now you're probably thinking, okay, but why doesn't the image tag have a closing tag? Well, there are some tags that are self-closing tags, and the image tag is one of them. But all you need to remember is this. If you want to show something on the screen, text, images, GIFs, buttons, even YouTube videos, there's a tag for that. And that, my friends, is a coding language. Yes, a coding language of tags. And you might even have heard of it before. It's called HTML. And I'm not even going to tell you what it stands for, because that's not the important part. What's important is that it's one of three languages that all websites are made of.
Really?
I'm not kidding. 100% of websites in this world use HTML. But back to our button. See, in our little app, it's the button that's the key. Because when we press it, something happens. More specifically, the number goes up. But we're nowhere close to making that happen yet. So let's forget about that for now.
Forget about it.
Let's make it so that when we press the button, an annoying pop-up comes up with a message. Now let's press the button, and there you have it. It works. So what we're saying here is that when this button is clicked, an alert window should pop up with this message. This is so powerful because this lets us run a piece of code that we can just refer to as alert and feed it the text that we want it to show. And in programming, this is referred to as a function. But the alert function is something that comes out of the box. So let's now write our own function. But we can't just write it here. Because up until now, we've been writing code that shows things on the screen. The image and the button, HTML, remember? But a function is not really something that we can see. And so it's not really HTML. Remember, HTML is just tags. What we need now is another language. We need...
You are your...
Yeah. I'm JavaScript.
Because JavaScript is going to let us actually make stuff happen when we press the button. But that also means that we need to separate our code. So we have a section for our HTML and then a section for our JavaScript. So let's do this. Let's add a body tag. And put all of the HTML inside of it. There we are, perfect. And now below the body, we're gonna put a script tag. And inside is where we'll write our function using JavaScript. And the first step is to come up with a name for our function. Any ideas? Oh, what about increase number? Oh no, wait, increase count, because we're counting up, right? That's good enough for me. But increase count is two words, which is a problem because it has a space in between. See, function names have to be one word. So let's smush the words together into increase count. But I'm still not happy because it's so hard to read. What if we capitalize the word count? There we go.
Genius.
But we have to write more code. We have to specify that this is a function, which we can do by saying the word function before the name of the function.
Well, duh.
Okay, we're getting closer. Remember the alert function we used earlier? Remember we could feed it some text that it would show in the window? Yeah, that's the cool thing about functions. You can feed it an input that it can use inside. And for that reason, we have to always remember to add parentheses after the function name. Now, it's important to remember that just because you can feed the function something doesn't mean that you have to. So we can leave ours empty. And the last thing we're gonna add is a set of curly brackets. Hang in there, we're almost done. Now all of the code that we're gonna write for this function is gonna live inside of there. So let's make it a little bit more spacious. There we go, looks much better. Wouldn't you agree?
Agreed.
See, this is important when it comes to code. Not only should it work, but it should also be easy to read for humans. Oh, and remember how earlier I told you not to get freaked out by the symbols? Yeah, the same thing applies here. Why are we using curly brackets?
Because I said so!
Now let's put some alert code in there to check if things are working. Oh, and we need to make sure to change up the button code as well. Here's our function, and here we're calling our function.
Hello, anybody home?
All right, now for the moment of truth. 3, 2, 1. Yes, it works. But we don't want an alert window. We want to show a number on the screen. But hold up now, we're not there yet. So let's see if we can make it work with the alert window first, and then we can switch it up in the end.
Huh? Pull the old switcheroo!
Okay, so the counting starts at 0. So we need to show 0 in the beginning. But if we put that inside of the function, that's only gonna show up when we press the button. So how about we put it above the function? Ah, see? The alert window came up first with the number 0, and then nothing happens. Unless we press the button. And then it says it works. This is important because code runs from the top to bottom. If we add another alert after this one and say 1 and then run this, it's gonna say 0 and then it's gonna say 1. You get the idea. So let's take away these. But this is where it gets a little tricky because every time we press the button, we wanna add 1 to whatever number we had before. So sure, in the beginning it's 0, but after a while it could be 7 or 15 or 100
or $1 billion.
It's variable. Yes, variables are exactly what we need because we can just come up with a general name for the number. Let's call it counter. And at any given moment, counter is going to have the number value that we want. So let's start by assigning counter to be 0 in the beginning. Let counter equals 0. There we go. And now we can use alert again. But this time, rather than saying zero, we'll say counter. Ah, now we're getting somewhere. Now let's go inside of our function and remove the text and replace it with counter plus one. Let's run that. We got zero. And then we press the button and we get one. But the problem is, if we press the button again, we keep getting one. But that makes total sense because we haven't changed the value of counter yet. So before we alert counter, let's assign it a new value. And this is where you might go,
great Scott.
Counter equals counter plus one? That doesn't make any sense. And I agree with you. In math, it doesn't make sense. How can something be equal to itself plus one? But this is programming, baby.
But are you using my babies now?
And in programming, the equal sign doesn't mean equal. It means that we are assigning a new value, taking away what was there before and replacing it with something new. And in this case, we're saying, hey, give counter a new value, which is the old value of counter plus one. I know, this takes some getting used to, but this is how it works. All right, now let's test this thing out. Oh, first click, and one, and two, and three, and it is actually working.
Yes! Hell yeah!
From here on out, it's just taking this thing and turning it into a polished-looking app, which it turns out is most of the work. So let's add the final piece to our app, which is the text that's supposed to show the number. And for that, you guessed it, we're gonna use another tag. This tag is a text tag. How many T's was that? This tag is a text tag. Four, and it's called H1. The H stands for heading, so it's normally used for the title of a page. There we go, we got a beautiful zero showing. Now we gotta find a way to use JavaScript to take this zero inside of the H1 and change it. All right, so here's the thing. When we run our code, it creates a document, which would be all of this. The image, the text, and the button. What we want is this right here. Well, it's actually not even that. It's the number inside the inner text. And so we gotta go in here and then inside of here, and then we can change this number. And in order to do that, we are going to uniquely identify our H1 tag by giving it something called an ID. So let's go in here and we'll say ID equals counter. Perfect. Now we have a unique way of getting exactly what we want. So now let's see if we can change this 0 into 100 by using JavaScript. All right, so we're gonna go up here, and first we're gonna say document, which again is the whole thing. But we don't want that. We want to search by the ID. And more specifically, we wanna search the elements. And the elements are just these. This is an element, this is an element, and this is an element. We wanna search for this one by using the ID that we have, counter. So let's say that. We'll say document.get element by ID. This is an inbuilt thing that we can just use, and we can give it the text counter. Okay, now we have this thing, but we don't want to change this whole thing. We only want to change this inner text. So we're going to say dot inner text. Now we got the thing, okay? Now we can say, hey, remove the old value and replace it with something new. Equals 100. There we go. Let's test this out. And now you can see it's 100. Not by using HTML, by using JavaScript. This is so cool. And you know what? We don't have to set it to a number. We could go in here and say something like YOLO and save. And there you go. You got YOLO. Okay, but we don't really need to change anything in the beginning, right? We only want to change the text when we press the button. So let's take away alert from here. And let's copy this and delete it from here and put it right under here. And we'll say this equals counter. Perfect. And now let's run it. And would you look at that? It works. Let's try again. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh my God. Have you ever seen anything as beautiful? Oh, you have, huh? Huh. I was hoping you wouldn't say that. But since you have, we gotta make this thing look good. Which brings us to the third and final coding language. CSS, which is gonna let us style up our app. Okay, again, since this is another language, we have to use a new tag before we can start writing it. We'll put this one at the very top. And we'll say style, close that, and then put the ending tag. There we go. Now let's start with something simple. Let's change the background color. And what do you know? We have the body tag that contains everything inside of it. So let's target that. We'll say body, and then we'll say apply this to it. Make the background color equal to, let's say, green. Let's save that. And there you go. It's really that simple. Now let's change it to black. Let's change green to black and save. And there we are. Which of course makes the text impossible to read. So let's change the text to white. So the text of course is this H1. And so we're gonna go here and say H1 and make the color to be white. Save. There we are, very good. We can also make the text larger if we want by saying font size and making that, for example, 40 pixels. Let's make it actually 50 pixels. There we go, much bigger. I think you get the idea. Now, for us to make this thing look like the final product, there's a lot of CSS we gotta write. So we're gonna use some movie magic here to fast forward through this. And there you have it, our finished drinks counter. But see, this is technically a website, but we can easily turn this into an app by adding a little bit more code, which I'm not gonna bore you with.
Wingardium Leviosa.
And now we need to just take this little project and push it out into the world. And there it is, right there, on my phone. Look at this, it looks like a native mobile app, even though it technically isn't. And that's it for this video. I really hope that you enjoyed it and that it wasn't too technical. And I also hope that you're feeling inspired to keep learning. If you are, you want to follow the link in the description because I've made something very special for you, which is absolutely free. That's all for now. I'll see you in the next one.